cheer from flu complications like pneumonia.
Sadly, each year, some children will die from flu.
Older people are at high risk too.
So is anyone with a health condition like asthma, diabetes, or heart disease.
That's why everyone 6 months and older should get a flu vaccine each year.
And the best way to protect kids younger than 6 months who are too young for the flu vaccine is for everyone else in the family to get vaccinated.
It's easy.
A lot easier than moving your family to a distant island.
Find a nearby place to get vaccinated at flu.gov.
Brought to you by HHS.
She knows a hollow from a double up. She does snapbacks, backslides, shoots the curl. Bethany Hamilton knows everything about surfing. She just didn't know about the shark. But just months after the attack, and with only one arm, the 13-year-old surfs again. And now she's ripping it better than ever. So next time life puts a little fear in you, just think of Bethany Hamilton hanging 10 on top of a heavy wave. That's real courage. Pass it on.
From the Foundation for a Better Life at values.com.
The place for St. Louis to gather and praise. Shine 690.
For a fresh take on this week's Sunday School lesson, you've just tuned into the Gospel Cafe with me, your host, Pastor Will Goatley.
Oh, we're live at the Gospel Cafe. Good morning, good morning, good morning.
Good morning. How's everybody doing there at in St. Louis?
We're doing great, Pastor.
Well, I want to say welcome once again to the Gospel Cafe. We are grateful to be broadcasting live over KSTL 690 AM. It's a beautiful day, and anytime you get to wake up and open your eyes, it is a beautiful day.
Amen.
And I want to ask you, Reverend Campbell, do you have any shout-outs today?
I do, sir. Shout-out to Westside Missionary Baptist Church. A big shout-out to Pastor Bobo and Sister Bobo. I love you guys. And a big shout-out to the Alton NAACP. I'll be joining them next week for a Martin Luther King actually on the 20th for a Martin Luther King celebration. So shout-out to the Alton folks.
Well, praise the Lord for that. I also want to give a shout-out to the Calvary Missionary Baptist Church and the wonderful, loving family there at Calvary. We're also grateful to wish everybody a happy new year. This is the first broadcast for 2013.
Yay.
And it's a good way to start off the year in church. I want to encourage everybody to start off the year at their church. And if you're looking for a church home, we invite you to worship with us at the Calvary Missionary Baptist Church, 2822. Dr. Martin Luther King Drive in St. Louis.
Amen.
Amen for that.
Amen for that.
And I'm also wanting to say January is consecration month at Calvary, and we encourage folks to give the first month of the year time for fasting and prayer, consecration to the Lord. We're going to be encouraging our people to participate in a Daniel fast this month and to participate in fasting and prayer. And we want to encourage other folks, Christian believers, to dedicate time during this month. Dedicate your first fruits. We call it first fruits, your first paycheck, your first day's wage. Dedicate that to the Lord, which consecrates your income for the year. And we have First Fruits Weekend coming up this coming weekend, next week, to the Lord. That dedicates your time and consecrates your time to the Lord. And God deserves our best. And if you start out well, it helps you end well.
Amen.
So we're grateful for that. And so we're looking forward to Consecration Month at Calvary. I know other churches are going to have Consecration Month services, and we'll share a little bit more about those in the weeks ahead. And this is also the month for a new beginning for President Obama's second term.
Yes, it is.
Some people will be participating in inaugural balls and inauguration parties. And it's also the weekend of the Martin Luther King weekend, so people will be celebrating the life of modern-day prophet, Dr. Martin Luther King, Jr. So we got a lot going on in January.
An awful lot. That's good stuff, though. Good things.
Amen. And that you'll be with the Alton NAACP, you said?
Yes, on January the 20th. I'm just so honored to be able to come and bring a word to the people on that date at Tabernacle Missionary Baptist Church there in Alton on January the 20th at 3 p.m. So I'm looking forward to sharing with them.
Well, I'm glad. I'm glad you got a chance to promote that, and looking forward to any of our friends listening in Alton or Edwardsville or anywhere on the east side to try to make it over to Tabernacle Baptist Church so that they can be a part of that celebration.
Amen.
Amen. Well, we have a good lesson on today, a lesson from the Paul's letter of Philippians to the church at Philippi. In fact, the whole month of January, we'll be studying from the second of Paul's prison epistles. We studied from the book of Ephesians last month, and this month it'll be the book of Philippians. It's kind of a follow-through on when we left Paul in the book of Acts, chapter 28, that he was under house arrest. And these letters kind of follow upon that theme that Paul wrote letters to churches while he was under house arrest. And this letter, the book of Philippians, is another one of what's called the prison epistles.
Yes. Absolutely.
And it's good to study books of the Bible. So somebody may have read the first chapter of the book of Philippians, but we're not going to read the whole chapter, but we are going to read some verses from Philippians chapter 1, and that'll be verses 12 through 26. And so we'll jump into the lesson about proclaiming Christ. And Reverend Campbell will ask if you will read from verses 12 through 18, and I'll read verses 19 through 26.
Be happy to do so. I'll be reading from the New King James Version, starting at verse number 12 in chapter 1. But I want you to know, brethren, that the things which happened to me have actually turned out for the furtherance of the gospel, so that it has become evident to the whole palace guard and to all the rest that my chains are in Christ. And most of the brethren in the Lord have become confident by my chains, are much more bold to speak the word without fear. Some indeed preach Christ, even from envy, strife, and some also from goodwill. The former preach Christ from selfish ambitions, not sincerely supposing to add affliction to my chains, but the latter out of love, knowing that I am appointed for the defense of the gospel. What then? Only that in every way, whether in pretense or in truth, Christ is preached. And in this I rejoice, yes, and I will rejoice.
And Reverend, I'll pick up verse 19 in the New King James Version, which says, "For I know that this will turn out for my deliverance through your prayer and the supply of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, according to my earnest expectation and hope, that in nothing I shall be ashamed, but with all boldness, as always, so now also Christ will be magnified in my body, whether by life or by death. For to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. But if I live on in the flesh, this will mean fruit from my labor. Yet what I shall choose, I cannot tell. For I am hard pressed between the two, having a desire to depart and be with Christ, which is far better. Nevertheless, to remain in the flesh is more needful for you. And being confident of this, I know that I shall remain and continue with you all for your progress and joy of faith, that your rejoicing for me may be more abundant in Jesus Christ by my coming to you again. And so we are looking at this first chapter of the book of Philippians, where we're learning how Paul is able to look at the circumstances of his life in such a positive way. And one of the overarching themes, Reverend Campbell, is the theme of joy. What is your take on joy?
Well, Pastor, you just read my mind here. I love this book because Paul really talks to us as Christians and speaks loud and clear about being in a hard place. What is the attitude that we have when we're in a hard place? We can go, we can become bitter in the hard place. We can become withdrawn. We can become avoidant. We can become angry. Or we can do what Paul did. Knowing that he was there for the sake of the gospel, he chose to rejoice in the hard place. And I believe that is a tremendous lesson that if we can grab onto as Christians, man, we're going to be able to do great things for Jesus.
Well, Reverend Campbell, I think it does take a sense of spiritual growth and perspective in order for us to really see things and rejoice in a hard place.
Amen.
You know, he's in prison or he's in house arrest and he's got chains, he's bound, but he is determined to look at this as something potentially positive instead of something that's going to be depressing.
Amen. Amen. And we have a choice. I think what you're talking about, Pastor, is a choice. He made a choice. He made a choice to keep his eyes focused on Jesus and the purpose that God had called him to. And I think that helped Paul a lot in keeping perspective. It was all about Jesus. It was never about him.
And that's what we find in verse 12. If we look at verse 12, he's saying that he wants the people to know that the things that have happened to him have actually turned out for the furtherance of the gospel. And like you said, it's more about Jesus than it is about him. I'm reminded of the Purpose Driven Life book where it talks about it's not about you. You know, it's not about us as people. It's about the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's about being a believer in Jesus Christ.
And Pastor, you know, in that runs so contrary to what the world tells you. The world tells you it's all about you.
Yes.
We can supersize it because it's all about you. You can get supersized drinks, supersized fries because it's all about you. You don't have to really conform to too many boundaries and structures in society because it's all about you. But yet the gospel, in a sense, our calling is not about us. It's about
yes.
Jesus Christ and the furtherance of the gospel.
And the fact that, you know, this verse 12 talks about there was also gossip about Paul.
Uh-huh.
You know, sometimes when people hear that you're in jail, they think you're in jail for doing something wrong.
Mm.
But they were wondering, you know, well, why is Paul under house arrest? Well, we recall in Acts that he was unjustly taken in the temple. Somebody accused him of defiling the temple. He was going to be killed by a mob. He had to be rescued by the authorities. One of the governors was looking for a bribe, kept him in jail, waiting for him to give him a bribe. A new governor comes, takes over the case, and Paul appeals to Caesar. And the next thing you know, he's on a boat headed to Rome. And this is a tale about castaways, you know, about Gilligan's Island. They get run aground on the island of Malta on the way to Rome. He ends up in Rome, and Acts 28 tells us he ends up being jailed in his own house. So he is looking at all of this stuff that has happened to him and saying, instead of the gospel being curtailed, this has turned out for the gospel to be further preached.
Wow, and that's a powerful thing, and maybe we can talk more about that after our break, Pastor.
All right. Well, our first break is coming up, and we want to just say thank you to one of our ministry partners, and that's the Bridewell Christian Adult Daycare. We would like for you to consider using the Bridewell Christian Adult Daycare for your loved one to socialize, have field trips, breakfast, lunch, and snacks are provided. Please contact Sister Madeline Bridewell at 314-531-3388. Once again, that's in St. Louis, 531-3388. And we will come back on the other side of the break and at least try to get a few more verses in.
Amen.
The highest mountain, looked all around, couldn't find nobody. Went down into the deepest valley, looked all around down there, couldn't find nobody. I went across the deep blue sea, couldn't find one to compare to your grace, your love, your mercy. Nobody greater than you. I searched all over, couldn't find nobody. I looked high and low, still couldn't find nobody. Nobody greater, nobody greater, no, nobody greater than you. I searched all over, couldn't find nobody. I looked high and low, still couldn't find nobody. Nobody greater, nobody greater, nobody greater than you.
That is such an awesome song, Nobody Greater. Isn't that right, Pastor?
Amen. I really am blessed by that song. Well, I guess we'll try to jump back into this lesson. Excuse me. Reverend Campbell, sometimes we have found that people have mixed motives for doing ministry.
Say that.
And sometimes, you know, we're not supposed to judge folks, but we can be wise in evaluating what people are doing and sometimes what their motives might be. And Paul was the victim, so to speak, of some impure motives of other preachers of the gospel.
Yes. Yes, and but yet, well, it just shows us that, you know, you see different things out there, but we're still supposed to press forward.
Amen. And maybe victim wasn't the right word, because he said, I'm still going to rejoice that the gospel is being preached.
It didn't change his attitude, did it?
It didn't make him bitter. And that is another lesson I guess we can learn from the Apostle Paul, is he was maintaining his joy even when others were preaching against him. If we look at verse 15, it says, some indeed preach Christ even from envy and strife. And let me just stop right there and say, you know, sometimes even in our churches, we have people who are doing ministry, but their goal is division.
And that's such a terrible thing when you run across that. But you're so right, Pastor. It does happen, unfortunately.
it's unfortunate, and it does take spiritual growth and maturity not to get sucked into other people's hidden agendas. I remember being at a church where folks in ministry were writing letters telling people in the church how wrong I was on a certain doctrinal topic. And I met with them and said, I don't think that's the right way to go about it. If you have a disagreement with me, the best way to do it is for us to sit down and talk together instead of passing out letters trying to, create some problem or division in the church. The better thing to do is to sit down and reason with the person that you don't have a good understanding of where they're coming from. And even in this passage of Scripture, we learn that it's nothing new under the sun, that some people will preach the gospel, but their motivation might be envy, which means they were envious of Paul, or strife. They were trying to create strife in this church at Philippi. And either way it goes, it's something negative, but Paul is saying, they're preaching the gospel, so that's the main thing, that somebody gets saved. Even if their motives might be envy or their motives might be strife, and that is not always an easy thing to swallow, to look at the positive aspect of people getting saved, even if the motivation that somebody is using is envy and strife.
Yes, and Pastor, a lot of people want to just stop attending church and to pull away from the body of Christ and use that as justification for no longer engaging themselves and using their resources, be them financial, be them their gifts and times. They use that as a reason for pulling away. And we have to really, really fight that and recognize that there is the greater call, which is souls being saved, the lost being reclaimed, people being healed and delivered. We have to stay focused on the work of Jesus Christ, or else if we start focusing on man, we'll tend to pull away.
And that's so true. I do think that the context in which Paul is writing is he could not personally go to defend the gospel or correct the teaching. So that's why this letter is being written. And evidently, he was being told about these other preachers and teachers by the letters that came to him. In fact, this response of the book of Philippians has to do with some money that came to him from this church. And he was thanking them for their care and concern in the gospel.
Money, the root, what is it? The love of money is the root of all evil?
Well, the love of money is, but he was thanking them for their support. And, even though the church supported him, some of the people in the church were trying to create envy and strife. And I guess the point I want to make is sometimes, even though everything isn't going easy or well in a church, God can still get the glory. People can still be saved, and people can still encourage one another. You know, there is no perfect church. There are sometimes people in the church with hidden agendas, right. And a lot of times people, as you said, will kind of give up on folks and stay home, but it's not the whole church. It may just be one or two or three people in the church creating a lot of confusion, but I do believe that God's will can still be done even if a few people in the church are having problems with envy and strife.
Yeah, and sometimes that comes, the reason I mentioned that scripture is because when people see others being blessed in those ways, financially, seeing a ministry grow and people being blessed, they see the materialism of it. They see the blessings that are coming, And it just opens up their hearts for things like envy and strife and quarreling and those types of other things. But you're so right. It amazes me how God works in the midst of our mess.
Amen to that. There is a message through the mess. Amen.
There is a, oh, that's a sermon now. If you hear me preach it one day, Pastor.
Amen to that. But I don't want to stop there because he said some also preach from goodwill.
Mm, yes.
You know, so even in the same church, some were preaching and teaching from immature motivations, and then some had mature motivations. And in verse 16, he's saying the former preached Christ from selfish ambition, not sincerely, supposing to add afflictions to Paul's chains. So Paul understood their motivation. You know, they wanted to be the big shot, or they wanted to be promoted, or they wanted to be looked up to. And so their own ambition was the reason for them doing what they were doing, supposing to put Paul down by lifting themselves up. But I remind people, you don't have to put somebody else down to be, you know, for God to lift you up.
Amen.
You know, it's not a zero-sum game. It's not just God only got a few places of elevation, so I've got to pull somebody else down so I can have room to be lifted up. That's not how God works. There's a song we sing that what God has for you is for you.
Amen.
But the blessings of God, nobody can take away your blessings if they're meant for you. And the same way with others who are working in the church. You don't have to attack the chairman of the group in order for you to be the chairman. If you just outwork everybody, they'll make
that,
you the
Pastor.
Chairman.
Say that, Pastor. Come on now.
And you don't even have to talk bad about somebody to be promoted. If they see your work, because most people don't want to work. They want the position, but they don't want to work. And if they see your hard work, they'll be glad to give you the job.
You're
because
out
a lot of people just want the accolades.
You're out on the limb at the Gospel Cafe this morning. Stay out on that limb. I'm loving it.
That's right. Well, but I've seen it happen. I've seen it happen where some people want the title, but they don't want to pick up the towel and wash somebody's feet.
Come on.
They don't want to pick up the hammer and nail the nail in the wall so that the picture can be hung. They just want to sit back and tell you if it's crooked or not.
I'm going to have to use that one.
All right.
I'm about to use that one. But 'cause what you're saying is what's missing is what was evident in those farmers in verse 17, but the latter out of love. And there's that love piece again. Out of love, they were preaching the gospel. They were infused and inspired by Paul. And so that just gave them greater boldness, greater energy, greater zeal, greater passion to go out and to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. It was love, love.
Amen. And that's what we need more of, even in the church. I believe this lesson is an encouragement for people who are working in the church to not try to work to be seen of men, but to work out of love.
Amen.
Not to attack somebody else, but to do what God has called me to do. And if that means working in the background, working behind the scenes, then just do that because, you know, the Lord is watching you, not because some man or woman or somebody is taking notice of it. And I know that everybody appreciates being applauded, and everybody appreciates being appreciated. But there are times in our spiritual journey that we have to get beyond the recognition of people and do some things because we know it needs to be done and that it's our responsibility.
That is rich. That is rich, Pastor, because love is about really pushing others forward.
Mm-hmm.
You know, love is not about pushing yourself, but it's about pushing others forward. If you really love someone, you're pushing them to be the best that they can be, to be all that God has made them to be. And so if everybody's doing that with each other, I mean, that's a wonderful, wonderful thing.
And isn't love a wonderful motivation?
Isn't it, though?
You know, instead of envy and strife, love motivates us to do work for the gospel and work in our church. We love our church. We love the people. We love God. We love the gospel. And we know that sometimes people are in hard places because that's where their journey takes them. But I'm not going to heap other burdens on them because of their situation. I'm still going to serve because of love.
Yeah, and love is work. I think we've shared this before. We've talked a lot about love in our previous broadcast, but you have to work to keep your feet rooted and grounded in love.
That's so true.
Yeah, because you just don't know what other people are going through. You don't know the brokenness and the hurts in their life. And sometimes it's like loving a porcupine. Have you ever tried to hug a porcupine? You know, sometimes it's hard work, but it's something that we're called to do as Christians.
In fact, I've heard an illustration about that, you know, that porcupines try to get close enough not to prick each other, but close enough to give warmth. And, you know, people who are prickly people, you try to love them, but you know you can't get too close to them because right now they don't know how to respond. Except, you know, being a little prickly.
Yeah. But I have found with some, not all, with some, if you just keep standing there with your feet rooted and grounded in love, I've seen that in women. They'll call the ministry wanting help. But in their brokenness, they don't know how to reach out. They don't know how to accept and receive the help. But if you just remain there with your feet rooted and grounded in love, I've seen them come around and begin to receive, you know, the words that you're trying to share with them. And I've just seen God do some wonderful things.
Well, isn't that about growth? Isn't that what discipleship is? That there is a transforming power to love. There's a transforming power to the love of God. I spent last month just preaching on John 3:16, and one of the points I made is that if God didn't send Jesus into the world to condemn the world, why do we condemn the world?
Amen. Well, Pastor, we're going to have to share more after our 30-second break, after our break here in about 30 seconds.
We have a break, and I know they have a station ID
coming
up.
Yes, they do, yeah.
We want to thank Angels Dream Daycare for their partnership in this ministry, and we want to encourage people to call Sister Angela Brandon for a wonderful daycare for your child, our grandchild, our niece and nephew to go to. And if you call 314-652-1668, once again, write this number down, 652-1668, then you will discover a wonderful daycare for your child, birth through 10 years of age, and they do welcome walk-ins. So after this break, we'll come back and continue our Bible study.
KSTL-AM. Shine 690 and shine690.com.
Even if I try, but still my soul refuses to die. Mm-hmm. One touch will change my life. Take me to the King. I don't have much to bring.
One touch will change your life. Isn't that an awesome song, Pastor?
Amen. Welcome back to the Gospel Cafe. And this is your host, Pastor Will Goatley, and I'm with my co-host, Reverend Carla Campbell. And Reverend Campbell, once again, tell the folks about the NAACP in Alton.
Yes, I've been asked, and I'm so honored to be able to speak at the Alton chapter of the NAACP, their Martin Luther King celebration on January the 20th at 3 p.m. So would love to see anybody in the Alton or the Illinois area over there at Tabernacle Missionary Baptist Church. Pastor Buford is the pastor of that congregation. Would love to see everybody there on January the 20th at 3 p.m.
Amen. That's a wonderful opportunity to celebrate the life and legacy of Dr. King.
Amen.
In fact, Dr. King is an illustration of people kind of preaching from envy and strife and goodwill.
Yes.
You know, some people had issues with such a young man leading the Montgomery bus boycott, but one reason he was picked was because he was a new pastor in town. He was young and hadn't made enough enemies yet. And so they put this young preacher up to lead the Montgomery bus boycott. And it took over a year, but the bus company changed its tune about putting blacks in the back of the bus, and the modern civil rights movement was pretty much launched from the Montgomery bus boycott and the young preacher named Martin Luther King Jr. So some people didn't appreciate that. In fact, he had enemies, jealous. Mm. Of his rise, because some people have been in the civil rights movement a long time and hadn't gotten this kind of recognition that young Dr. King received. But he couldn't let that stop him. And I'm grateful that the Lord is able to use people and in spite of others and get his ministry across, even though some people have envy and strife, but some people still have goodwill, and we thank God for that.
Amen. Amen.
Amen. So, as we get back into our Bible study, we want to remind people that not only are we on the air at KSTL 690 AM, but we're also streaming live at www.shine690.com. And we want to encourage people to listen. And you can listen from all over the country on the Internet.
Yes.
Well, Reverend Campbell, as we dig a little deeper into our lesson about proclaiming Christ, Paul says some pretty profound things in this next section of our scripture. He says in verse 19, thinking about the context in which he's in, he's under house arrest. He's heard some good things and some discouraging things from this church in Philippi.
Mm-hmm.
But he says, "For I know that this will turn out for my deliverance through your prayer and the supply of the Spirit of Jesus, mm-hmm. according to my earnest expectation and hope that in nothing I shall be ashamed, mm-hmm. but with all boldness as always, so now also Christ will be magnified in my body, whether by life or by death." Now, that lets you know that he was more interested in the gospel than even in saving his own life.
That almost made me want to shout, Pastor, because that was
yes,
so
ma'am.
Inspiring, just those two verses.
Yes, that Paul has confidence in Christ. And, you know, confidence in Christ comes from experience.
Mm.
When you've been through the storm, he was through the storm. When you've been shipwrecked and drug out of the water, when you've had a viper bite your hand, you shake it off into the fire. When you've had your life threatened by a mob, you know, when you've already died to self, then death holds no more strength over you.
Wow. Wow. I've heard a saying that faith is really not faith unless it has been refined, unless it's been under some fire.
So true.
Yeah, and so unless we've been under some things in life where we have been pressed on every side, then that's when you know Jehovah Rapha. That's when you know Jehovah Jireh. That's when you really know him, is when you've been put in those places where you can only depend upon him.
Well, isn't it true that we only know those revelations of God when we've experienced something, you know, deep that we needed God to reveal himself in those ways?
Yeah, and there's somebody out there now who might be going through something very deep and very challenging, and the enemy in your mind, you're going, what have I done? You know, what have I done wrong? Why has God abandoned me? All of those types of thoughts, when really it's God is perfecting you.
Amen. And that perfecting process is a process.
Amen.
And sometimes we have to, well, all the time, we have to accept God's process, but sometimes it's our perspective on the process that helps us go through it.
Yeah, that's rich. That's rich.
It's the earnest expectation and hope that helps us endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ.
Mm.
See, the earnest expectation, when I was in school, my professor said, the earnest expectation is knowing that the train is coming down the track, but you can't see it yet. So you kind of strain out over the track, off the platform, to look for that train, because you know it's scheduled to come, it's supposed to be there, you just can't see it yet, but you know it's on the way, and so you just kind of strain forward, looking for its arrival, looking for some smoke on the horizon or some light at the end of the track to let you know that it's on the way.
Mm.
And we know God is able to deliver.
Oh, yes, yes. What you're saying is that his word does not return unto him void. He's going to bring it to pass.
Amen.
Woo.
Whether we be bound or free, God is able to deliver.
Wow.
And whether we are sick or well, whether we are poor or rich, whatever we find ourselves going through, if we wrap our faith in earnest expectation and hope, it will help us endure what we have to go through.
Amen. Amen. That is good stuff. I mean, I feel like shouting.
Well, I feel like crying.
Oh.
I guess one shout and one cry.
Oh, yes. All for the same reason, the joy of the
Lord. All for the same reason. Amen to that. And then he says, you know, in verse 20, he talks about he wants Christ to be magnified in his body or in his life, whether he lives or dies. He's not going to be ashamed.
Amen. And that's that. It's not about me, you know, and that is so hard. It's an easy thing to say, but boy, it can be challenging to live it out. It's not about me. It's not
that's
about
so
me. It's not about me. You know, it's not about whether God increases my finances or not. It's not about whether God puts me in a certain house. It's not about, you know, it's not about me. It's about God being, or Jesus Christ being magnified in every area of my life. All I have to do is just make sure that I am doing what he tells me to do.
Amen. And every Sunday before I preach, I ask the congregation at Calvary to lift their Bible up high and to repeat this after me, that I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, because it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone who believes. And I ask them to shout, I am a believer. I want to put that seed of faith into their hearts, that what they're getting ready to hear is the gospel of Jesus Christ. And no matter where they work, or go to school, or in their home or neighborhood or community, that they don't need to be ashamed of this gospel. They don't need to be ashamed of the gospel, whether they drive in a car or whether they're waiting on the bus. And you don't have to be ashamed of the gospel whether you're working at McDonald's or you're working at A.G. Edwards. You don't have to be ashamed of the gospel whether you find yourself in jail. Somebody might be listening to us, and they may be in jail today. But you don't have to be ashamed of the gospel whether you are in bonds or whether you are free. This gospel is the power of God.
Yes.
To save souls. And that's a good thing.
Amen. Now, that's a good thing to get ready for our break in 30 seconds, Pastor.
Okay.
That's a good summary right there. I think we ought to settle on that one.
Okay.
We ought to settle on that one, boy. That's a good one.
All right. Well, I do want to say one more time during the broadcast that the Bridewell Adult Daycare is an excellent place for your loved one to be, to go to. They will receive medications from a registered nurse. They will get arts and crafts, socialization, meet their friends. It's more than just sitting around. It's a lot of social interaction and care that they are given. So please call Sister Madeline Bridewell at 314-531-3388. Once again, that number is 531-3388. And please tell Sister Bridewell you heard about her ministry on the Gospel Cafe. And when we come back from the break, we'll head for the home stretch.
Somebody lift your hands as we celebrate the greatness of our God. He's great and he's greatly to be praised. This little worship song that says this, our God is awesome.
My God is awesome.
He can move mountains.
He can move mountains.
Keep me in the valley.
Keep me in the valley.
Hide me from the rain. Come on,
our God is awesome. My God is awesome.
He heals me when I'm broken.
Heals me when I'm broken.
Gives strength where I've been weak.
Strength where I've been weak.
Forever he'll reign.
Forever he'll reign.
Come on, say my God is awesome.
My God is awesome.
He can move mountains.
He can move mountains.
Keep me in the valley.
Keep me in the valley.
Hide me from the rain.
Hide me.
My God is awesome.
My God is awesome.
He heals me when I'm broken.
Heals me when I'm broken.
Strength where I've been weak.
Strength where I've been weak.
Forever he'll reign.
Forever.
Come on, if you believe it, lift your voice and say,
my God is awesome.
Come on, if you know he's awesome, say,
awesome.
Come on and lift your voice.
Awesome.
Awesome.
God is awesome.
Amen to that.
Yes.
I am grateful for the opportunity to study the Bible on the air and online with our listeners. And I'm grateful for the opportunity to share this ministry with you, Reverend Campbell.
Oh, with you, sir. It's my honor, my privilege.
Well, I want us to kind of get a little bit deeper into the lesson. If you look at verse 21... this is a verse that has just always intrigued me. Paul says, for to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. And sometimes I think about all of the people who paid the price for us to enjoy the blessings that we enjoy today.
Yes.
Whose life they did not count so precious that they could not give it up for Christ. And as I was studying the lesson talked about under the persecution of one of the Roman emperors, Diocletian, that there were people, the Latin word was traditores, I think that's how you pronounce it, but they were people who had given over names of believers and given up church property because of the persecution from the Roman emperor. And after the church, after Christianity became the state religion, people didn't want to have anything to do with those folks who had turned over names or given up people or who had renounced Christ. And, you know, it's kind of a hard thing to see people turn around from their beliefs under persecution. It makes you, you know, it just makes you upset, but it makes you have compassion because there are people who just could not handle the persecution at that time and gave in to it. So for them, they wanted to live more than to die. And they counted their life too precious. And I think about Christians under persecution today. There are Christians in countries where Muslims are in charge, and they can't build a building called a church. They can't proselytize, what they call proselytize. They can't evangelize. They have to meet in secret. And if a Muslim converts to Christianity, he's disowned by his family or she's disowned by her family, and sometimes a death threat, a fatwa is put out on them to kill them because they've been disowned by their family. And yet, you will read about people coming to Jesus in spite of that, in spite of persecution, in spite of what it takes in some countries to be a Christian. In America, we think we're persecuted because we can't pray in schools. You know, we think we're being persecuted because somebody can't put a Bible on their desk at work. But, you know, there are some countries where persecution means your life is going to be taken.
Yes, and it's not a quick death. It's a torturous death that they often endure. And you know, when I read those verses as well, Pastor, it really makes you do a self-evaluation. Because if I was put in a situation where someone had a gun to my head or someone was going to torture me, if I did not renounce my faith and my belief in Jesus Christ, could I stand?
Yeah.
I mean, and I think that's a challenge for all of us to really ask ourselves, if we can't stand, if we can't, what's the one scripture say, if we can't run with the footmen, if we can't, if we can't run, how are we going to run with the horses, with the chariots? If we can't endure the little bit of challenge that we receive in this country, how are we really going to endure if things were to change in this country?
Because I'm reminded of the German pastor Dietrich Bonhoeffer, who wrote the book about the cost of discipleship. And he talked about how discipleship is free, but it's not cheap. And the point being that even though Jesus paid it all, we all have a price to pay. There is a cost to being a follower of Jesus Christ. And Dietrich Bonhoeffer was arrested for his faith. And, you know, some people will be surprised to find out. One reason he was arrested was he was participating in a plot to kill Hitler. And, you know, the plot got found out. But, you know, I'm not condoning that. I'm just saying that his faith could not allow him to see an injustice go on without trying to do something to stop that injustice. And so in his writing from jail, he wrote to encourage what was called the professing church under Nazi occupation in Germany, so that they would be faithful to preach the gospel in spite of being persecuted. And it makes you wonder how deep the roots of our faith really go. Because so many people can be persuaded to give up, to sit down on God, And the only thing that really happened to them was somebody hurt their feelings in some way in church. But, you know, we have to be a little stronger than that.
Amen.
And this lesson talks about that.
Amen. Amen. And it's almost like as you were talking, a kind of an equation came in my mind or a scale, and that is the weight on the side for Jesus Christ. My love and devotion to him has to far, far, far exceed my love and devotion to myself.
Amen. And like you said, a self-exam or a self-evaluation is good for us to have from time to time.
Yeah.
Because we can assume that we are strong in our faith and then allow something to disturb us so much that it makes us question our faith. And I do think it's an opportunity in today's lesson to see, you know, what is it that we really value?
Yeah. And, you know, Pastor, we have about 3 minutes left before we close the program. And so, you know, there's a couple of really rich points in here. You know, a lot of people thought with that scripture that Paul was suicidal, that Paul was actually thinking about killing himself when you really, really understand Paul's love for Jesus Christ, he wasn't suicidal. He was really, really, really understanding his relationship with Jesus.
Right, because he wasn't really talking about killing himself.
No.
He was talking about being under a death sentence by the Roman government.
Absolutely.
You know, because at any point, he could have been executed for his faith. Just so happens that we believe that he was released and then had some more ministry before he was arrested again.
Yes.
But you never know, you know, when the Roman emperor can proclaim death or life just by lifting up his thumb and putting his thumb down. You know, we've all seen it in those old movies
mm-hmm.
where the gladiators can live or die. You know, that's kind of what he was under the thumb.
He was under the thumb.
I guess that's what they call it, under the thumb of the Roman emperor. And you're right. You know, some people want to interpret that in that light. But, you know, the deeper meaning is when you're under the threat of death, you can choose, and Paul chose to live because he said it would be better for you all in the church of Philippi that I live and continue preaching and teaching the gospel and encouraging you all. But either way, I win.
Yeah, absolutely. He's going to come out victorious no matter what.
He's going to be victorious if he's released from prison, and he's going to be victorious if he's executed.
Yeah. Well, Pastor, we have our last minute here. I'm curious, what are some of your key points here as we close in our last minute?
Well, I just want to encourage people who are listening to the Bible study today to serve the Lord no matter what you're going through. Don't give up on God. You know, whatever you do for Jesus will last. And that's what the song says. Only what you do for Christ will last. How about you, Reverend?
Well, I just want to encourage people to have an attitude of rejoicing through your trials, because we are not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Keep pressing.
Amen. And we want people to grow in the knowledge of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and grow in grace. And so we want to say thank you for listening with us on today.
All right. Thank you much.
God bless you.
God bless y'all.
You have been listening to the Gospel Cafe. This is Pastor Will Goatley, your host. To contact me, friend me on Facebook at Will Goatley or follow me on Twitter at Will Goatley. I personally invite you to join me at the Calvary Missionary Baptist Church on Sunday mornings. Our worship starts at 10:30 a.m. We're located at 2822 Dr. Martin Luther King Drive in the city of St. Louis. The zip is 63106. We're two blocks west of Jefferson in Midtown St. Louis.